Hello, everyone, watching the video of us three recording the audio podcast, Airline Pilot Guy, episode 216. Enjoy the show. Airline Pilot Guy, episode 216. Hello, you're listening to the Airline Pilot Guy Show, the view from our side of the cockpit door. I'm Captain Jeff, your host, broadcasting live from Studio 6015 in the Marriott Hotel in Columbia, South Carolina. In this episode, an airliner hits a drone at Heathrow. Yep, I said it was just a matter of time. A college student removed from flight because of suspicious behavior. The FAA inadvertently released voluntarily disclosed information. The real cost of simulated stalls, and the latest installment of Captain Nick's Plane Tales, The Last of the Phantoms. So get all settled in. Tray tables and seat backs in their upright and locked positions. Electronic devices powered on. Flight 216 is ready for pushback. Hello, and welcome to the Airline Pilot Guy Show. My name is Jeff Nielsen, also known as Captain Jeff. I'm a captain for a major legacy carrier in the United States. And joining me today, the lovely Dr. Steph, who is obviously a doctor and a commercial rated pilot. Hello, Steph.
Hi, Jeff. Good to be back again. And yep, that's right. Physician. If you want to be real specific about it, I guess you could say I'm an osteopathic physiatrist. That's how's that for well, a mouthful?
Yeah, and that's what I usually say.
When I grow up, I'd want to be a pilot. So
an osteopathic physiatrist?
Yes.
A psychiatrist? Whoa, I need one of those.
No. Very different. Very different from what I do.
Okay. Yes. Well, excellent. I'm glad you're here. And speaking of the need for a psychiatrist, this guy probably could use one. Captain Al is with us from across the pond. He is a captain for an airline based in the UK. We call it Royal Jet. Or he calls it Royal Jet, and he's also the founder of Flight Fear Solutions.
A very good morning, good afternoon, or good evening, depending on where you happen to be. It's a pleasure to be here. Thank you for the invite.
Oh, you're so welcome. I enjoy listening to you on other shows like Pip's Plane Safety Podcast and a very entertaining Plane Talking UK podcast. Carlos and Matt made the mistake of having the two of you on their show, but I'm glad they did because it was very, very, very entertaining. Can't tell you how many times I was laughing out loud, you know, in public spaces with earbuds in my ear.
Inappropriately, you know.
Yeah. But around my house, I mean, people are used to it there, but, you know, out in public, not so much.
Well, you guys, you did the show at a, you know, kind of a reasonable hour here in the U.S. So I actually got to listen to that one live, and I was just sitting out on the dock at home, and it was a great morning slash afternoon. So
I think really it's fair to say that all four of us had really good fun. Pilot Pip and myself had been out the previous night. I've taken on some of his nutritional advice role. So I've been mentoring him in how to prepare for his marathon. Now, unfortunately, I understood that he was doing a food eating marathon, but apparently it involved running, which was completely an alien to me. And I didn't understand. I was building him up to get his calorie count up into several tens of thousands by the end of the week. That's what I thought the role was. So we went out for a curry and some beers, and he's saying to me, but, you know, I've got to go running. I'm so, well, why do you have to go running, for heaven's sake? I mean, you should be eating. And then he explained that it's all... and then he explained, and it was like, well, I can't help you.
But wait, you run a marathon.
I have. That was a moment of madness many, many years ago. And I've said to many people since that marathon running, when you've done one of two things will happen. You'll either vow never, ever, ever to do one again, or you'll become a serial marathon runner. So I have a sneaky suspicion that Pip's going to be in the former category, but we shall see.
Yeah. Now, obviously, Dr. Steph is in the latter category.
The latter. Yeah.
She runs a marathon, I think, once a week. Madness. Something like that.
No. I ran 15 miles on Sunday. So, not a marathon.
Yeah, me too.
Just a few. Yeah.
All right. So, tell us about flight fear solutions. Not everybody understands. You know, we all know that you're a captain for a European carrier, but we many of us don't know this little secret occupation that you have.
Well, for many years, I've had an active interest in helping people who have a fear of flying. It's as simple as that. All three of us here who are on the video side of the chat room, and many, many people are on the typing side of the chat room, love flying. It's, you know, it's a passion. It's an interest. You know, it's something that we enjoy doing. But there are a segment of society who have to travel or need to travel by air that, quite frankly, find it a very, very unsettling or frightening or a nervy experience. And I've always tried to help them along the way. And then some years ago, it started to develop into people would ask me, or passengers would ask me the question about this or a question about that. And it eventually evolved into a business where I help people to understand some of the elements of a phobia, to break down the components of it such that we all understand that, you know, a lot of phobias are irrational because that's part of their function. But to try to understand by a greater knowledge of what we do as airline pilots, what happens on board an aeroplane before we get on board the aeroplane, such that if we've got a greater knowledge of what's going on behind the scenes, it's much easier to rationalize certain events. And the classic one is a passenger who's nervous of flying will be on the aeroplane and they'll hear the cabin crew call bell go. And their immediate thought is, what's going on? What's happening? What's going wrong? And of course, we know that invariably it's just the cabin crew communicating, saying, has anyone got any more teas or coffees, or have you got the chicken meals down there? Because they use the cabin crew call bells as a means of communication. And when you explain that to a lot of passengers who are nervous, or some of my clients, they go, is that all? You go, yeah. Most of these calls and communication methods are mundane as mundane can be. And then a little bit of that phobia or fear is taken away for them, because that's one bit of knowledge that they didn't have previously that they can now use to go, actually, nothing's going wrong here. Everything is just operating as normal. And that's basically the sort of ethos. It's breaking down phobia by knowledge and information.
Yeah. Well, I think most phobias are due to a lack of knowledge about whatever it is you're afraid of, right?
Yeah, absolutely. The classic one for people who have a phobia of spiders is they see a spider on TV. They know that it's on TV. It's not going to suddenly jump out of the box on the wall or, you know, in the side of the room. But for them, they see that spider as if it's really there in the room with them. So that's the irrational side of it. And breaking those components down helps greatly for people who may not necessarily wish to travel, but maybe have family in a different part of the world. So flying by air is really the only way they can do it. Or quite a lot of my clients are business people who have no alternative but to fly.
They have to go.
And that makes it harder in some ways because they have commercial pressure to fly. So that's where I come in and try to help them. I don't come from a psychology background. I'm just an airline pilot who has some certain skills and abilities, and I've studied cognitive behavioral therapy and neuro-linguistic programming to try to help to explain to people on a face-to-face level what they can do to minimize some of their anxiety.
Yeah, but I think from one standpoint, I think people are, even though you don't have that psychology background, people don't necessarily want to hear all of that from a psychologist. They want to hear from someone who's got the experience, who has the knowledge, who can explain it in real terms to them and break it down, like you said. I think that's far more important, and can give them, you know, examples and experience, real life experience stories. That counts for so much more.
Absolutely. I mean, there's so much in the way of misunderstanding or myth, if you like, about the work that we do, the stuff that we take for granted. One of the big subject areas that is quite common amongst a lot of my clients is the fear of turbulence. And we're not talking about the, you know, severe turbulence. We're just talking about any levels of turbulence, because for some, they perceive that a little bit of turbulence that sort the, you know, Captain Jeff and I wouldn't even register as being the start of something much more destructive. And of course, for, you know, majority of the time, it's just a little bit of very, very light turbulence, not even worth a mention. But for them, it's not the same way.
A good example of that is in our chat room. Mr. 1971 says, I get really frightened and stressed when a plane experiences turbulence. What are the chances of planes crashing due to turbulence? I'd say probably a 30% chance. Wouldn't you? No, I'm just kidding. Long time ago,
on
maybe.
On a good day.
On a good day. No, the chances these days of an airplane crashing caused by turbulence is very, very slim. I mean, I don't know what the percentage will be, but, you know, several decades back when they didn't have the technology that we have today, radar and other forecasting, meteorological forecasting tools that we have available to us today, perhaps it was a little bit, and the altitudes that they were flying back in those days were much lower and much more exposed to the extreme convective activity of thunderstorms and that kind of thing. But these days, the chances of crashing strictly because of turbulence are very, very slim.
Statistically, you're more likely to seriously injure yourself falling out of bed than being involved in an airplane turbulence incident.
Yeah,
there you go.
And that's all airplane turbulence incidents, even just, you know, severe turbulence where you're not wearing your seatbelt or something like that, and or projectiles, or is that what you're talking about as well?
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, all elements, really. I mean, I don't wrap things up in cotton wool for my clients. At the end of the day, everything that we do in life has an associated risk. There is a risk of traveling by air in the same way as there's a risk of going out through your front or back door. You are no greater risk at being on an aeroplane than you are by leaving your bed. So that is the important thing to register. Yes, people do get injured in severe turbulence incidents every year, but if you look at the number of people who travel by air each year, you will see that we're down to those very, very small percentages. And of those people who are injured, how many of them are critically injured? Well, I can't think of an occasion in my recent, you know, sort of memory where anybody has been critically injured in a severe turbulence incident. So let's not worry too much about that. Let's make some sensible precautions, like when the seatbelt sign is on. As a passenger, we put our seatbelt on and we make sure that anyone else in our party has done the same. And then we've already mitigated some of the risks associated with traveling by air.
So my takeaway from this, Captain Al, is that we just don't get out of bed.
Or don't go to bed in the first place.
Or don't go to bed.
Just wrap yourself in bubble wrap and
suffocate.
You get to go. Suffocate.
That's another risk. This is really
starting. See, risks with everything. Risks with everything.
This is really starting to turn into a downer of a show. So anyway, so let's move on to a little discussion about some stuff before we start into the news, if you guys don't mind. I was getting off an airplane Friday, actually, my last trip. And I was walking into the Atlanta airport terminal, and I'm out of the corner of my eye, I see this gray shirt that has this Fly Acme Air logo on it. And I'm thinking, well, that looks a lot like that is the Acme Air t-shirt. And it was it was the guru, Chris Cheatwood. And he was going through Atlanta. He lives in northern Alabama, and he is one of the hosts of the Hey Techies show on YouTube, and it's a podcast at Jacksonville State University in Alabama. And he was on his way to Denver through Atlanta to actually present at a big conference there. So we went and had a bite to eat, some breakfast, and then walked back to the gate, and I was going to let him come on the airplane with me and, you know, check out the cockpit and all that kind of stuff. And the gate agent quickly said, And I said, excuse me? And she said, does he have a ticket for this flight? And I said, no, he doesn't. And she said, I'm sorry, but you don't have an escort badge. You only have a regular pilot ID and you can't escort him down there. So she was doing her job and she was nice about it.
She didn't say, don't you know who I am?
Yeah. Don't you know who I am? She goes, yeah, I know who you are. So get that guy out of here now.
And absolutely not.
Yeah.
Yeah. That so, well-known ice-breaking phrase. Don't you know who I am? Yes. Yeah, <come on.
laughs> That'll get you through any situation.
You know what I love is when somebody does that and they get on the speaker, excuse me, everybody, does anybody know who this person is? Apparently he doesn't know who he is. Anyway, so good to see you, Chris. If you're listening to the show, hopefully your conference went well in Denver this past weekend. Another person who is part of the APG community, and you've heard me talk about him before, he's an employee at Acme, works the ramp, the econ course, and his name is Cayman. And he is a student pilot, and he's actually, I think this is the third or fourth time he's been on one of my flights. And I didn't even know he was on the airplane until they were getting off the airplane in New York at LaGuardia. And he was heading up there with his mom to see some family up there. But he is about to take his private pilot check ride. And I believe he's also interested or checking out the ab initio program at JetBlue. Hopefully I'm allowed to tell everybody that. If not, then just disregard
it. Too late now.
Yeah, I can edit that out.
Now everyone knows.
So I hope that if he proceeds with that, he can kind of let us know what's going on with that. But anywho, so we have that out of the way. Don't forget, we have T-shirts for sale on 32write.com, a link in the show notes. And don't forget to use your promo code APG to get 10% off. And when I checked earlier today, the Farnborough shirts, we have 16 shirts to be sold before the shirts go to press. And the Acme Air, you know, the classic airline pilot guys shirts, we have another 33. So we're not even halfway there yet for that lot of 50. So
when I looked today, those numbers were from the 14th. So they're a couple days old. So. Okay. Maybe they changed.
Yeah, just perhaps. I hope so that everybody can get their shirts. And Google Play Music just opened up the gate for streaming podcasts on the Android platform. So if you're an Android user, of course, the easiest way to do it is just to download the free Android Airline Pilot Guy app. And there you'll find the podcast, YouTube, Twitter feed, calendar, all kinds of stuff in there. And that's probably the easiest and best way to do it. But if you listen to a lot of other podcasts via whatever app uses Google Play, I guess there's a Google Play app. I don't know. Google Play Music.
I guess.
But we're on that.
I guess for other.
Yeah. I'll put
if you have a device other than iOS.
Yeah. I'll put a link to that in the show notes. And then you can click the link or you can just go to Google Play Music. And you're not downloading the podcast, but you're streaming it. So you can listen to it via streaming on Google Play Music. And just go to Google Play Music and do a search for Airline Pilot Guy. And you're good to go. Let's see. Slack. That's our perpetual chat room at the APG. And if you're interested in joining the perpetual chat room, please tweet Hillel. And that's H-I-L-L-E-L, except for don't use any L's. Use ones in the place of the L's. And tweet him with your email address, and then he'll send you an invite, and you can join us on Slack, which is a lot of fun. And let's see. The last thing I have here is that Pilot Pip, the host of the Plane Safety Podcast, is going to be, as we just talked about earlier, running the London Marathon this weekend on Sunday. And the Plane Talking UK guys, Carlos and Matt, are coming up with some kind of a rig. I think I saw a picture of it in the group Twitter messages that we exchange at times. And
it looks like it might be difficult to run with.
Yeah, I don't think he's going to get very far when he's wearing this contraption to do the live broadcast on PT.
Also looks like he might be joining the Ghostbusters.
It does look a lot like it.
Yes.
Hopefully they'll come up with a new rig that is a little bit lighter. And I'm interested to see and hear the goings on in London and listening via the Plane Talking UK podcast site. So hopefully they'll give us lots of information and links on how we can watch all of this live. So be looking
and
for
don't forget, he is raising money for charity for a good cause to help Huntington's disease research. If you go to his website at, planesafetypodcast.com, I think. If not, I'll fix that. We can fix that in the show notes. But go there and there's a link to the his London Marathon appeal, and you can donate if you're able to.
Yep, it is not too late for that.
Not too late. Nope.
Okay, break.
Help
what
Al.
What happened to Al?
I don't know, but I'm going to get more beer because it's really
go
hot
get some
in my
beer,
room.
And then we'll figure out why. Oh, I need to unlock this. Okay, here we go.
That's probably why.
I'm sorry.
Yeah.
I was.
I thought you left one open.
No.
I'm
cheers.
Sorry about that. It was really weird because I've got the Blab app on the iPad, and I happen to be looking at the chat room on the computer screen that's behind that you can't see, and I was still on the iPad, but I disappeared off the stream. So I'm not quite sure what happened there. So
that's weird.
Yeah.
What happens with me is that I'll be looking at another. I'm just using a laptop screen, so I have multiple windows, and they're all covering each other up. So a lot of times, I'm not looking at the actual, the video.
Yeah.
And so I don't know. So I got back from talking about something or whatever we were just talking about, and I saw that it was just Steph and I. I went, "Oh, what happened to Al?"
Yeah, but like I say, on the iPad app, I was still there. It was just disappeared off the stream. So I really don't know. Sorry about that.
Well, I apologize. I had that seat locked so that nobody else would call in.
I thought you had left a seat open, though, I thought he would just be able to call back in.
I did, but I keep getting these. I'll just leave it open. But so, folks, if you're in the chat room and you try to call in, you probably won't be answered because we're just trying to keep it. This is a little bit different than most people do Blab. We're actually using Blab to show kind of behind the scenes of us recording a audio podcast. So it's kind of like some of those shows on ESPN where you see them talking, but they're actually doing radio programming. But you actually see them on video. So that's what we're doing. But we're not ESPN. We're much, much bigger.
And also for the guys in the chat room primarily, I had a bit of a baptism of fire of the technology associated with this. So so I'm learning as well as to how to be involved. So just bear with me.
You're doing great. Doing great. All right. So we got through the administrative section of the intro of the show. Anything else we should talk about before we move on to the coffee fund?
I think that's it.
Okay. Let's do that then.
Johnny, how much more coffee?
No thanks.
I love coffee. I love tea. I love the Java Jive and it loves me. Coffee and tea and the Java and me. A cup, a cup, a cup, a cup, a cup.
That is the Ink Spots. So they recorded that in 1940. This is the Java Jive. We play that because I love coffee, I love tea, and I love the APG community.
Wow. Cover, huh? That was nice.
And the coffee fund is your way to support the show financially if you have the resources to do so. If you're interested in doing that, head over to airlinepilotguy.com/coffee. A couple different ways to do it. You can use the coffee fund classic method, which is PayPal, or you can become a patron of the show via Patreon. And again, all that information is there either on the app. You can look at the section that says support the podcast, or you can go to the airlinepilotguy.com website and click on the coffee fund. Since the last show, we've had a couple that use the PayPal classic method, Paul Baker and Chris Randall. Thank you for your contributions, part of the Coffee Fund cadre, and no new patrons since the last program. So again, that's patreon.com/airlinepilotguy if you want to go directly there and check that out. Otherwise, all that information is available at airlineplanetguy.com/coffee. And thank you again, everyone, for your contributions.
I love Java, sweet and hot.
And now, it's time for the news. Okay, we're going to start off with something that we have talked about so many times on this show and many other aviation podcasts. It's just a matter of time before it happens. And guess what? It's happened. British Airways Airbus A320 struck a drone on approach into Heathrow. And that was just, what, a couple of days ago? Or was it just as recent as yesterday?
April 17th. I think it was
Sunday.
Yeah, it was 2 days ago. And
Sunday or Monday?
I think it was, April 17th, according to Simon's Aviation Herald. British Airways Airbus A320-200 from Geneva to London. Who cares how many passengers and crew were on board? They were on final approach to runway 27 left when the crew reported a drone had impacted the aircraft. I would say that the aircraft actually impacted the drone, but that's just, I guess, a matter of perspective. The A320 continued for a safe landing on runway 27 left and taxied to the apron. The airline reported the aircraft received minor damage when an object impacted the nose section of the aircraft. The aircraft was fully examined and has already been cleared to depart on its next flight. London police reported an object believed to be a drone impacted the nose of the aircraft. No arrests have been made so far. The investigation is ongoing. So we have that. There's an article from news.sky.com that talked about the fact that the police, again, are investigating, trying to find the owner of the drone. Scotland Yard said police based at the airport are looking into the incident. And let's see. Yeah, pretty much reiterates everything that they talk about on the Aviation Herald broadcast. Now, on not long ago, I think a 777 coming into land at Heathrow missed a drone, or what they believed to be a drone, by about 10 feet or so, I think. But I'm not sure about that one. And then this is...
it says same height and 25 meters.
Okay.
So still pretty close.
Very interesting. Now, this...
Well, I've not been able to establish from the news feeds or anything else as to whether the authorities have been able to recover the drone, because one would imagine that the drone was fatally damaged in its glancing blow with the highly sophisticated Airbus A320. So I'm surprised that they've not, recovered any bits of the drone, to be honest. Not that I'm expecting the owner to have their name and address on it, but nonetheless, it would, categorically confirm that it was a drone strike.
Give you some information. And a lot of those drones do have cameras or GoPros or things attached to them. If you could, I don't know if they can recover any of that if it wasn't too destroyed or damaged. You can maybe figure out where it came from.
Hang on. Breaking news. Just got this in from the Associated Press. A London-based drone enthusiast is suing Heathrow Airport for flying a passenger jet right through his toy. Simon Williams, 35 years old, said the drone was his pride and joy and the best 800 pounds he'd ever spent until a British Airways Airbus A320 flew directly through it, reducing it to worthless garbage. He told us, "I was just flying my drone like I always do, not filming anything I shouldn't or looking into bedroom windows or anything, just normal drone stuff, you know? Then all of a sudden, this airliner arrives out of nowhere, flies right into me. No indication. It didn't try to avoid me. And I'm pretty sure it was going way too fast." Then all of a sudden, it didn't even stop afterwards to swap insurance details. It's pilots like that that give the rest of us sky users a bad reputation. Of course, this is a spoof that someone sent me from newsthump.com entitled Drone Pilot Furious After an Uninsured Passenger Jet Crashes Into Him. So, no, we don't know who. This is Simon Williams. If it is actually Simon Williams, it's just a purely by coincidence.
I'm sure
any similarities to actual persons.
Yeah.
Coincidental.
Yeah. Absolutely. I'm sure that British Airways and Mr. Williams will be happy to exchange insurance details. One would imagine that the repairs to the Airbus A320 probably far outweigh the £800 that Mr. Williams has lost.
Hey, that's probably that's a quick way to lose £800. I could use about 25 to 30, actually. All right. So in all seriousness, this is a serious thing. I'm sorry that I tried to give it a funny twist, but luckily it was just a strike to the nose of the A320 and not sucked into one of its engines, which I think would have caused a lot more damage. So, we really need to get serious about this education, I guess, of folks out there operating drones so they know that they should not be flying them above a certain height within a certain distance of airports, et cetera.
On a sort of like reverse psychology point of view, it's slightly unfortunate that what we believe to be the first, impact of an aeroplane with a drone or whichever way you want to look at it, hasn't actually caused any great event. Because if it had gone into an engine and had caused a significant event, I think there would be a bit more of a public outcry. Because it's not caused any damage and the aeroplane's been dispatched within a couple of hours, there's the risk of it being perceived as a non-event. Whereas, of course, we all know that there's the huge risk of, when this right. happens in the future, that it causes a lot more than just a glancing blow. But it's getting the public on board the idea that, if your friend, is flying their drone near an airport, then, this isn't fun. This isn't a good thing to do.
And, a couple of points. We still don't know what type of drone this actually was. And there's a huge variety of drones out there in terms of size and potential damage that they could cause, I suppose. And then the other thing I was thinking, too, like you were saying, I don't know how much of it just still is ignorance. I mean, there's the coverage that the press in the United States at least give to registering drones and, drone near misses and whatnot seems to be pretty consistent. You hear stories all the time, but still, I think there's a lot of just general lay people out there who go out and buy these things and don't even realize they live under, the approach path to an airport. And they're just out there using them, not thinking about it, taking pictures and putting things at risk.
But it's kind of amazing. You never noticed those airplanes flying right over. I mean, to be high enough for the airplane to hit it on approach. I mean, that means that the flight path has to be pretty darn low over your house. And I guess assumptions that people know that they're right underneath the flight path for a major airport.
Right. You would think people would know, but
yeah,
I think there's still a lot of ignorance out there.
Yeah,
unfortunately.
Right, though, the potential impact.
Education is huge.
Yes, education is the key to this whole thing. Not so much criminal prosecution, but just, or at least educating people to know that, hey, you're going to get prosecuted. You're going to get thrown in jail and fined big sums of money if you do this. I think you're right, though, Al, that this could potentially backfire. And they say, see, it hit an airplane. No big deal. Now, what's the big deal? Why are they worried about these drones?
Yeah, I mean, it's getting the public to understand, or the greater public to understand, the real potential for a catastrophe here, which, the people who are in the chat room, etc., we all, can see that because we have an interest in aviation, or we have applied the amount of intelligence that is required to see that this is not a great combination. But we need to get everybody in the greater public on board to effectively police it, because the authorities can't police it. Certainly in the UK, there's not that I'm aware of, there's any sort of registration process. How many drones are in the United States before the registration process started? Nobody knows. So who is going to police it? So it's not going to be the authorities. It's going to be very difficult to track the owner of this drone at Heathrow, as it will be on many, many other occasions. So we need the public to police it in some ways. You know, if someone buys a drone for their child or their brother or whatever, it doesn't take much in the way of education to say, look, you know, don't be a fool. Don't try and go and, you know, fly it near aeroplanes because you could kill people.
Exactly.
By the way, somebody in the chat room, they're having a discussion about, you know, what to do with, controlling these drones, et cetera. And I saw a recent article in the news that the FAA has reiterated that it is a federal crime in the United States to actually shoot down a drone. So that is not the solution. Although,
so if you see your neighbor out there and you live under, you know,
well, tell him, urge, you know, cheer him on and urge him, but and then just kind of under your breath say, you might have to go to jail if you do that.
Yeah.
So, yeah, unfortunately, you can't shoot him down, which begs the question, you know, those companies that are coming up with these drone catchers and drone killers and things that interfere with the GPS signals and all that kind of stuff. I think that if I'm reading this correctly, that all of those things are not legal. That's interesting.
It's technology has outsped legislation, hasn't it?
Yes. Yes, it has. All right. Moving on. I'm sure we'll hear more about that whole issue with drones and
flying. I cannot imagine it's going to be the last incident.
No, that's the first, but.
Well, we said it was a matter of when, and now it's a matter of how often.
That's right. That's right.
Yeah.
Hey, Micah said in this news article, and several others did as well, and just happened a couple of days ago. No, earlier this month. I'm sorry. Oh, I didn't realize it was that long ago. But it's on the current news cycle. In fact, when I was prepping for today's show, I was watching one of the major news channels, and they were discussing this story. A college student who came to the United States as an Iraqi refugee was removed from a Southwest Airlines flight in California earlier this month, April 6th, after another passenger became alarmed when she heard him speaking Arabic. The student, and I'm not going to try to pronounce his name because it looks difficult to pronounce, is a senior at the University of California, Berkeley, was taken off a flight from Los Angeles International Airport to Oakland after he called an uncle in Baghdad to tell him about an event he attended that included a speech by United Nations Secretary General Ban Ki-moon. I was very excited about the event, so I called my uncle to tell him about it. He told his uncle about the chicken dinner they were served and the moment when he got to stand up and ask the Secretary General a question about the Islamic State. But the conversation seemed troubling to a nearby passenger who told the crew she overheard him making potentially threatening comments. Mr. Makhzoumi, the college student, 26 years old, knew something was wrong as soon as he finished his phone call and saw that a woman sitting in front of him had turned around in her seat to stare at him. She headed for the airplane door soon after. He told his uncle that he would call again, and when he landed and qualified it with a common phrase in Arabic, inshallah, meaning God willing. That's when I thought, oh, I hope she's not reporting me because it's so weird. But that's exactly what happened. An Arabic-speaking Southwest Airlines employee of Middle Eastern or South Asian descent came to a seat and escorted him off the airplane a few minutes after his call ended. The man introduced himself in Arabic and then switched to English to ask, why are you speaking Arabic in the plane? And the college student said he was afraid and that the employee spoke to him like I was an animal. I said to them, this is what Islamophobia got this country into. And that made him very angry, and that's when he told me I could not go back on the plane. And so this just happened a few days, actually just recently, I guess after this incident, Southwest Airlines also removed a female passenger of Somali descent wearing a scarf, and because she asked to move seats or something, and the flight attendant basically told her that she had to leave the airplane. And when asked if, you know, what the problem was, and she said that she just didn't feel comfortable with her on the airplane. So we have a couple recent incidents regarding this, and I thought this would be a good discussion. What do you guys think?
Is it a federal offense in the United States to be a Muslim?
No.
Nope.
Is it a federal offense to speak Arabic?
No.
No.
So on the first assessment, then, these two individuals haven't been doing anything remotely wrong.
Nothing.
So what we have is a public misconception about people from other parts of the world, other races, religions, or other language speakers. And I'm afraid that that comes down to education. Just as a slight elaboration for people who are listening to this who haven't traveled in the Middle East, the expression inshallah is very widely used. Air traffic controllers will issue a climb clearance and end the transmission with inshallah. It is no particular religiously orientated expression. It is used in a very kind of informal, just wishing you, you know, luck kind of thing. It is not particularly, yes, I mean, the literal translation is, you know, is God willing, or, you know, in God we trust, if you want to apply it that way. But it's not a religiously motivated wish. It's just, you know, climb to flight level 350, pat on the back kind of thing. So hearing inshallah is no indication.
It's no different than saying bless you to someone who sneezes.
Absolutely.
It's not a religious thing.
Absolutely.
It's just, you sneezed.
Yeah.
Bless you.
That's a really good analogy, Dr. Steph. So unless the people who were on the aeroplane understand Arabic, how could they have any idea what the conversation revolved around, and therefore judge, you know, on what the possible implications of these conversations were?
Well, I will say that the person that brought this all to the attention of the flight crew did speak Arabic. And
oh, they did.
I thought that's what I read. I could be wrong about that, but just to play devil's advocate,
sure.
Yeah, because I thought I read one of the, maybe it wasn't this one that we're looking at, but that she heard him saying some phrases that sounded like a terminology that they use in jihadist organizations. He admitted that he was talking about the Islamic State, and so. To play devil's advocate again, I'm not saying I believe this, but if you go through security and you start talking about a bomb, even though you're joking or saying that somebody's wearing something and they're the bomb, whatever, you know, that is going to draw attention to the security people, and they have the full right to keep you from even going through the security system to get out to the airplane. So I think that, you know, we're not getting the whole story. Maybe we're getting the whole story. I don't know. We're seeing his side of the story. I'd like to, you know, hear other information regarding this, but it does seem, I agree, that we're spring-loaded to be a little bit too sensitive when it comes to somebody speaking a language we don't understand, seeing maybe somebody, a Jewish person, an Orthodox Jew, doing their prayers. I don't know if you've ever seen them do that on an airplane. And they're, you know, speaking in Hebrew, and it's a little jarring if you've never seen that before. And but as you said, a lot of this has to do with understanding other people's cultures and languages and religions.
Well, and I'll tell you what, it can happen even when you're speaking the same language, even if you don't understand the context of what someone else is saying. And this happened. I'll just relate a real quick story. Well, it was, when was it? This was last year. I was traveling with a friend of mine who happens to be in the same field that I'm in. And we do a lot of interventional procedures involving the spine. There's a couple of professional organizations we belong to, one of which used to be called the International Spine Intervention Society, which, if you put together the acronym there, is ISIS, which is what we called it just nonchalantly for years and years and years. It's just ISIS. And after the whole Islamic State thing became more prevalent and people were talking about it that way, the society did change its name to the Spine Intervention Society. They just took out the international part of it. But it's really hard to break habits of, you know, calling something by a different name when you've called it by something for years and years and years. And we happened to be traveling together, just going on vacation, you know, me and my boyfriend and this other couple. And we were on the bus from the parking garage going to the airport terminal. And we were talking about one of the meetings later that summer, and we kept referring to it as ISIS. And my friend's wife all of a sudden like jabbed him in the, you know, with her elbow in his in his ribs and said, "You guys, you can't say that on this bus because people are staring at you. You cannot talk about ISIS on the way into the airport. They don't know what you're talking about, and they think you're talking about Islamic State stuff," even though we were just talking about going to a conference about spine-related procedures. So you just have to be careful about the terminology you use, the phrase, you know, the phrases you use, but also if you overhear someone saying something, maybe take a listen to what they're actually talking about and try and get the context there as well. So,
and if you can, because, you know, if you're speaking a different language that you don't understand and you only hear certain words, I guess basically what I'm trying to say is you have to kind of think about where you are and what you're doing, and that may, you know, unless you're trying to make a point about it, that you have to be smart about it and understand that you can't just say anything you want, especially in, you know, situations like this. Unfortunately, it's just the way our world is.
You should be able to, but you have to be, you really have to be careful about how you say things and how you phrase things. And it was just so, you know, I mean, just the two of us on our own, we would have had that conversation and not thought anything of it. But I mean, even though it was really early in the morning, like 5 o'clock in the morning, there were enough people on that bus that were kind of giving us unusual glances because we were talking about ISIS.
And I in the article, go ahead.
Yeah, I have a friend who is in a very unfortunate position because her first name is ISIS. ISIS is one of the tributaries of the River Thames in the UK, so it's not an uncommon first name, not a desperately common one, but I mean, you know, she's of a similar age to me, and you know, her parents thought nothing of, you know, calling her ISIS, named after a river in beautiful Oxfordshire, if I remember rightly. And you know, she's kind of resisted for quite a while to change her name by depot because of the implications of being called ISIS. It's her name. But as you can imagine, it certainly flags up on certain systems. And when she's talked about, you know, people's ears prick up. And, you know, that's just a person's name. So take anything out of context, which quite possibly these two situations where people have been removed from aeroplanes have been, you know, things taken out of context, people jumping to conclusions. Have to be very aware, you know, very aware and cautious of doing that.
We just talked about on the last episode about cultures and, or maybe it was a couple episodes ago, where you just, it's important to understand the culture that you're in, and if it's foreign to your own culture, or your culture is foreign to theirs. And, you know, it's common courtesy for us to understand that, you know, you don't do this kind of a gesture in this country because it's offensive to these people. So you have to be aware of your surroundings. And, you know, like, I guess maybe it was the Airplane Geeks show. They were talking about the flight attendants, the Air France flight attendants refusing to fly the trips to Iraq because
Iran.
Because of the having to wear the head coverings and, you know, the cultural accoutrement of the of that state. And so, you know, they were talking about the importance of understanding different cultures and being sensitive to that. So, I mean, maybe there's some blame to be spread all around here. I don't think it's and the person that if I'm reading this New York Times article right, and I may not be, the person that took her off the airplane was accused of anti-Muslim bias, but this person was a Muslim. I'm thinking, well, at least spoke Arabic, and they were of Middle Eastern descent. And it does say that a passenger reported him hearing him talk about martyrdom in Arabic, using a phrase often associated with jihadists. So perhaps this college student just wasn't thinking that other people were listening to him in close proximity. And you're on an airplane and people are saying, you know how close we sit to other people on airplanes. Yeah. And maybe he at that time didn't think about, you know, how this might be construed.
I mean, it's easy to get caught up in a conversation.
Yeah.
You know, that seems innocuous to you.
I'm not saying it's right.
And I think it all comes. No. Yeah. It's not right. But I think it all comes back to, you know, we've talked about a lot of different fears already, but this all comes back to fear of the unknown, fear of people who are different, fear of cultures that are different. I think that's a big part of it. Not saying that any of it's right. You know, you don't want to let your guard down completely in this day and age, but it's, you have to know where to draw that line. And I think that can be hard to do sometimes.
And I think it's also important to point out, in at least in this article and from what I've seen on television coverage of this, that this man is not suing the airline. He's just asking them to apologize for the way he was treated. Apparently, they probably could have done a better job of explaining why they were taking him off the airplane and putting him on, or not allowing him to fly on that airline again or whatever. I guess after the pulling him off the airplane took place, they didn't handle it very well. And the last paragraph of this article that I'm reading here says, quote, "My family and I've been through a lot, and this is just another one of the experiences I've had. Human dignity is the most valuable thing in the world, not money. If they apologized, maybe it would teach them to treat people equally." So I think, you know, the bottom line here is that this person felt like he was dealt, you know, an indignant or an appropriate, you know, situation, whatever. I'm not using the right word, but
I think it's always difficult in these situations because there isn't really a lay down protocol, and people are obviously having to kind of think on their feet in a quite a awkward and confined space, and you don't know how the person's going to react. It's the same as, you know, getting any passenger, you know, taken off the aeroplane for whatever reason. You don't know how inflamed they're going to be. You don't know how what the response is going to be. Are they suddenly start to become, you know, violent, aggressive, et cetera, et cetera. So there's always this sort of difficult scenario. So I think it's sometimes difficult to handle these things well because everyone's a little bit edgy anyway.
Yeah. At the end of the day, it's a judgment call. And if you're the one who has to make that judgment, you know, you have to, whatever the decision is one way or the other, you have to know that you can sleep soundly at night having made that decision.
Right.
So.
And the good news is that Mr. Makazumi was able to book a new flight on Acme Airlines. And he got home on that fine company's beautiful airplanes. Okay. Anything else before we move on? All right.
Nah, let's move on.
Okay. This is interesting. I get some news flashes from the Airline Pilots Association. Acme pilots are represented by the Airline Pilots Association. This is from the Airline Pilots Association International. An update on the FAA's inadvertent disclosure of personal information. And I said, say what? And then it says, some of you may have heard that in connection with the Federal Aviation Administration's response to a Freedom of Information Act request by a Fox News media outlet, the agency inadvertently released voluntarily disclosed information that otherwise should have been protected from disclosure under the Aviation Safety Action Program. You've heard us talk about ASAP before. Among the information released was pilots' names, the administrative action that was taken, and in some cases, the airline the pilot worked for. It's extremely important to note that neither the ASAP report itself nor the information contained in the report was released. So I'm thinking, what? Of course, we're hearing all these inadvertent disclosures and hacking and everything else. Of course, in this case, it was the FAA's fault. They gave them way more information than this news media outlet requested. And I was looking through some of the aviation airline forums, and from what I could glean from it, it sounds like this was from the FedEx pilot group, but I'm not sure. But I have not received any information personally from the FAA saying that any of my information was inadvertently disclosed. So just thought I'd throw that out there just in case some of you out there work for airlines that have the ASAP program And maybe you should look at your email to see if the FAA has tried to contact. I would imagine they probably send a letter to you, not an email.
That is more the way of the FAA.
Yes.
You get a letter 3 months from now.
So you have a little experience with that stuff.
I might have had some dealings with the FAA.
Yeah, I know. Not sure how much of that you want to share. Yeah. Okay.
You guys want to have dealings with some of the other aviation authorities around the world, and then you really will know what a good bunch of people you have in the FAA.
So we shouldn't complain.
And I'm just giving them a hard time. Just
so we shouldn't complain. That's what the captain now is saying.
Well,
probably so.
If you look at things like licensing costs and processing times and absolutely. Issues like that, then, you know,
we're very spoiled.
Yeah, I mean, the FAA send out, you know, pilot licenses, you know, all around the world for no additional cost, or in fact, you know, no cost at all. Whereas every time my aviation authority deems to want to send something to me, it usually requires a check of at least $100 to cover their administrational costs.
Well, you're a rich airline pilot.
Wow.
What's the problem?
Yeah, so it doesn't matter.
I'd be a lot richer if I wasn't funding the Civil Aviation Authority, that's for sure.
Oh. But you're right. We are spoiled here, and there's a lot of good things that the FAA does for us.
All right.
If you're from the FAA, we're not.
We're good on you.
You at all.
Yeah. Nice job.
Off the top of your heads, how many dollars would you have to pay to have an ATP issued by the FAA? Not for the courses or the training, just for the issue of the license.
I don't think I paid anything.
You don't have to pay. You just have to pay to the examiner. So whatever the examiner's fee is.
Okay. But you don't pay a single cent to the FAA to produce the license for you once you've done all the tests and exams and so forth. Yeah.
Zero.
Yeah. So having in the UK, having paid for the exams, the training, the examiner's fee, et cetera, and I'm going to quote just off the top of my head, I'd say that an ATP costs about $400 for the authority to issue.
Wow.
Wow.
And it's probably more than that, actually. But, you know, I don't want to do them a disservice.
Yeah. Give them the benefit of the doubt. Wow.
Yeah.
Okay. I'll never say an ill thing for the FAA again. Well, speaking of costs of things, I was looking at an article in Aviation Week, the real cost of simulated stalls. The FAA says U.S. airlines will have to shell out an estimated $80 million on simulator upgrades to better train pilots for certain weather-related events and handling aircraft beyond the stall angle of attack, a realm that continues to result in loss of control incidents and accidents. There is some concern, though, that the actual cost may be much higher when airlines attempt to obtain from airframers or third-party providers the extended aerodynamic envelope models needed for simulators to accurately reflect the handling characteristics of their fleets. We won't have long to find out, though. We won't have to wait long to find out. Carriers will need those models before March 2019 to begin providing pilots with specific simulator training in aerodynamic stalls, upset prevention and recovery, airframe and engine icing, bounced landing recoveries, and takeoffs and landings in gusty crosswinds. The five training enhancements were mandated by Congress in the U.S. and the 2010 Airline Safety FAA Extension Act, which was driven by the February 2009 loss of control crash of Continental Connection Colgan Air Flight 3407 and a slew of NTSB recommendations. To accommodate the upgrade, a portion of the existing cadre of approximately 335 flight simulation training devices in the U.S. or the U.S. airlines used for training will have to be assessed and evaluated by subject matter expert pilots and most likely upgraded to handle the new training areas. A key part of the equation was delivered on March 30th when the FAA issued a final rule defining how simulators must perform in the extended envelopes needed for the training, some of which are outside the normal pitch, roll, yaw, and angle of attack bounds. So basically, I'll include a link to this article in the show notes, but you can read a little bit more about this. But I love the idea that the FAA is requiring airlines to spend the money to enhance the simulators, to explore these envelopes, these extreme envelopes that we've seen several incidents in the last 10, 20 years. Air France 447, Air Asia 8501, et cetera, where the airplanes were outside of the normal envelope of operations, and the pilots didn't seem to know what to do in these cases because they'd never seen anything like this. And honestly, I've never seen an airline transport category airplane perform in these envelopes either, because the simulators that we're using now only go to a certain point. And usually as soon as you do a certain action, like, you know, relieving back pressure on the control yoke or stick and adding power, et cetera, you're out of the first indication of a stall. That they're wanting to train us so that we know what happens if you continue well beyond the first indication of a stall and you don't bother to try to recover from it, and then understand what happens with the airplane and how it reacts. What do you think about this, Al?
It's interesting, actually. We were discussing this in a company meeting just very recently. I wonder if Congress and the FAA have actually spoken to the handful of simulator manufacturing companies, because the feedback that we have as an airline, certainly over this side of the pond, is that the simulator manufacturers don't know how they're going to achieve this. They certainly are not going to be able to achieve anything by March 2019, because here we are in April 2016, some, you know, 3 years away, and they don't actually know how they're going to do it. It's not that they haven't costed it out, or they haven't, you know, worked out the program for re-equipping all of these simulators around the world. They simply don't know how they're going to achieve this, because when we look at, say, things like stall detection and recovery, so much of that is what we actually feel in the seat of our pants. The fact that if you take a large transport aircraft and try and stall it, and you said that you've never tried. I've had the opportunity to go up in an Airbus where, as part of a test flight, and I was only as an observer. We did stall it deliberately, and it really does shake quite violently, and you feel it in the seat of your pants. You are physically aware of the impending stall, and that's going to be incredibly difficult to recreate in a simulator. And similarly, the A321, when it does actually stall, the nose does drop quite violently. So you get that bunting over feeling that's in your gut, you know, that sort of feeling of weightlessness. You're not going to easily recreate that in a simulator. And these are the components that I agree with Congress and the FAA that, you know, we need to have as part of our training to help us to analyze what's going on wrong with the aeroplane. But I don't see that being easily achieved in a simulator. And the $80 million, well, a simulator costs the best part of that in as a single item. So, you know, to come up with that figure for upgrading all of the simulators that the FAA, you know, have a ticket for worldwide, that's well short of the money required, I would, you know, speculate at this stage, because the research and development costs aren't going to be short of that.
Well, they're saying that if the airline, the airplane manufacturer actually has the data to begin with, they're going to charge probably exorbitant sums to the simulator manufacturers and then passed on to the airlines, number one. Number two, the article goes on to say that in many cases, the airplane has never been flown in that envelope before. And so they really don't even have the data. So that's going to cost an incredible amount of money just to get the data to plug it into the simulation.
Absolutely. I mean, I'm not going to take a pop at your equipment, Jeff, but the A320 and the A321 are a fairly modern aeroplane. So the simulator modeling for those aeroplanes is fairly accurate. The simulators that we use are very sophisticated. But even now, they, no matter what you do, you can't bounce the aeroplane in the simulator. There is no programming for a bounce landing. It doesn't matter what you try and do in the simulator to get the aeroplane to bounce. So we can't realistically do bounced recovery in the simulator. And that's for, you know, a pretty modern aeroplane that is well equipped with all of the data packages for the simulator companies to do for their modeling. And that's something as simple as just, you know, bounced landing recovery. So
yeah, the airline can't take one of their airplanes out there and put a whole bunch of pilots in it and say, this is what we do when we do that, and then risk damaging or destroying.
Absolutely. I mean, airplane. We still do base training for our new pilots. So they still go and do, you know, touch and goes, you know, circuits and bumps, call them what you will, in a real aeroplane. Because that's still a legislative requirement here. And that is not without its risk. And that's just doing, you know, normal landings, let alone trying to introduce an additional element of risk and potential damage. And trying to bounce an aeroplane, well, you can almost guarantee the outcome for that.
And I mean, even that is not something that's done around the world. That doesn't happen here, right, Jeff? Just going out and doing circuits.
At ACME, it did occur when I was on the 7, when I got checked out as a co-pilot on the 727 in the early 90s, we were still doing what they called bounce rides, where you'd actually go up with four or five other pilots and training student pilots and go around to an airport like Greenville, Spartanburg, Greer Field, and do, you know, VFR mm-hmm. circuits and touch and goes, actually. And then you do a few of those, and then the next person would get in the seat and do the same thing, and you'd be gone for 4 hours or whatever, and then come back to Atlanta and you were finished. But it wasn't long after that they just couldn't spare the airframe to take it out of service to do that. And so, yeah, since probably the mid-90s, that hasn't happened at ACME.
Over here in Euroland, it's still a legislative requirement. Mm-hmm. There are certain elements, say, for example, when I did my cross crew qualification onto the 330 from the 320 / 321, as long as we used level D zero flight time simulator, there was no requirement to do that. But I obviously already had in excess of 1,000 hours on the narrow body. All of our new entry first officers will go and do circuit training on the real aeroplane. They have to do 12 landings.
I'm glad they still do that. I wish that we still were required to do that, yeah. But apparently not.
Yeah, six at day and six at night is the
nice. We didn't have any at night. They were all during the day.
Yeah. But one of those with pappies off, if I remember right.
Just to kind of get an idea of making your own descent path. Mm-hmm. Yeah. That's smart.
Sure.
I'm glad they still do that in some places.
I mean, it's obviously onerous on the airline because, like you say, to take an airframe out of the flying program to do that, and it's usually for the whole day because obviously you're doing it as a group of candidates, for want of a better word. And obviously there is an inherent risk in training on the real airplane.
That there is. All right. Well, all these news articles with links will be in the show notes if you want to read up a little bit more about each of those. And if you want to send us feedback regarding our discussion, feel free by sending your feedback to feedback@airlinepilotguy.com using the feedback section of the app or the website, calling up SpeakPipe, etc. All those ways to send feedback are available to you by just going over to airlinepilotguy.com. Speaking of feedback, it's time for the best part of the show.
Captain, incoming message.
Okay, we're going to start off with some audio feedback.
Hi, Captain Jeff. This is Dave, a retired airline flight attendant, 37 years with the world's favorite. How about us having a little input into your system? have a load of stories after 37 years with British Airways as a purser. Got your information from Nick, another airline employee. Okay, I'm not sure.
Who?
He used it to you. Dave, 77jazz@gmail.com. And don't forget to tune into my jazz show. It is called Sounds of Jazz, and you can hear it on TuneIn.
There's your free plug.
4 to 5, Tuesdays and Fridays. So we have quite a community of retired flight attendants, which I can tap into. We have many, many good stories. So I wonder if we could have a little bit on your... webcast or whatever. Anyway, Dave77jazz@gmail.com will find me. Okay, Jeff, take care. Dave Self, next British Airways purser, 37 years.
We'd love to hear some, tap into some of that experience and some of your stories, Dave. It's not really an interview show, so if you'd like to send us either email or audio or both feedback regarding some of the experiences you've had over your 37 years?
Quite a few.
Experience with the British Airways. What did he call that? The world's favorite?
Something like that.
Yeah. So
he might be biased.
Maybe a little bit, but very interesting. Sounds like you you have some nice anecdotal stories. So please feel free to send them in. So check out the jazz program. We'll have the a link to that in the show notes. And again, thank you, David, for contacting us. All right, continuing on. This is Brett. He says, I was on a flight out of Salt Lake City, Utah. There was an awful lot of turbulence once we were airborne. Common, I think, for the mountainous airports. So this is where the uncontrollable laughter started. We were talking about uncontrollable laughter on previous episodes of the show. I was on business travel and had a string of long 10 to 12 hour plus days. So maybe I was a bit on the sleepy side, but for some reason, watching all the passengers in the back of an Acme Boeing 717 freak out after every bump we hit was unusually humorous to me. I was trying to suppress the laughter, but I think the passengers around me thought it was a bit odd. Jeff, do you have any experience with the Salt Lake City turbulence? Yes. Is it common? Yes. And what was your worst turbulence in your time at Acme and or U.S. Air Force? Maybe this is yet another symptom of the APG syndrome. It could be. So thank you,
Laughing
Brett, for that.
Laughing inappropriately at turbulence? I think it definitely is a symptom.
It is funny sometimes when you're sitting in the back and you do hit some, you know, significant bumps. And when you hear people scream, like you feel like you're on a roller coaster or something.
Yeah. Just put your hands up and be like, woo! You know.
And it's just, it does kind of tickle you if you're not upset about it yourself. But yeah, Salt Lake City, because of the, as you mentioned, you know, mountainous areas and the wind flows, wind patterns and that kind of thing, not uncommon at all flying into or out of Salt Lake City, as Steph knows as well, because she used to live there.
And I lived there for about 10 years. There. Yeah.
Yeah, that it can be quite interesting.
Although, of all the times I've flown into and out of Salt Lake City, none of them were ever particularly turbulent. Maybe I've just been lucky. And, I mean, I fly in and out of Salt Lake City all the time. There's a couple things that are particular to Salt Lake that I guess could give you, not just the mountains, but... it's also very prone to temperature inversions as well, especially in the valley there. So as you're descending through those warmer layers on top, and then before you get to that cooler, stable air below, you may experience some more turbulence. But yeah, it does sit, you know, it sits right on the southern edge of the Great Salt Lake, the airport does. And then you're surrounded by the airport itself, I think is at 4,000-ish feet above sea level, and the mountains on either side are around 10,000 feet. So, we definitely get some turbulence from that.
Yeah. My personal experience with severe turbulence, I can only think of two times that I've experienced. Once in the Air Force flying through the top of a thunderstorm in a C-141 inadvertently because our radar wasn't working at night. And that was quite a ride. And then the other time in a 727 on approach and then subsequent go around because of a very severe wind shear and associated severe turbulence flying through a gust front approaching landing at Atlanta International. And that was so bad that all you could do is really just hang on. You could not, it was so jarring. You really couldn't see any of the instruments because everything was shaking so violently. And you just hope that it wasn't going to last very long. And luckily I was in an airplane that was very, very well built and wasn't worried too much about, you know, wings falling off or anything like that. But it was something that really got my attention. How about you, Steph? Do you have any stories about turbulence?
So this past weekend, I went out flying, took a little cross-country flight from Winston-Salem out to New Bern, which is closer to the coast, purely to go eat fried seafood. That was the entire purpose of the trip. And splitting time and getting out and flying, obviously. It was a gorgeous day, you know, beautiful here in the South this time of year. Sunny blue skies, no wind on the ground, pretty calm. Get up in the air and immediately it's really, really bumpy, kind of like being in a washing machine, you know, all over the place. And it was like that until above about 5,000 or 6,000 feet. So we flew over at about 7,000 feet. And as we got closer to the coast, the winds picked up significantly. And it wasn't that they were steady winds, but they were gusting to 26 just continuously. So it'd be nothing. And then all of a sudden, a 26 mile an hour gust. And we're flying a little Piper Archer. So we're getting bounced all over the place. No joke. Like being in a washing machine, kind of like you said, just hold on, hope that it's going to stop soon. Mm-hmm. It was hilarious though, as we were flying over, we'd just passed Greensboro and someone came on the frequency, was looking for their, pick up their IFR clearance or something out of Burlington, I think. And he made a comment. He's like, can you make the bumps stop? Or can you do something about the bumps? And some smart aleck guy somewhere came on and said, use your checklist or run your checklist for that.
Don in the chat room is saying something about the front range of the Rocky Mountains here in the U.S. And yeah, you can experience some pretty violent mountain wave.
I've had more turbulence flying from Salt Lake City into Denver than ever flying into Salt Lake City.
Yeah. And by the time you get to Salt Lake City, you know, all the terrain is pretty much the same. Yeah. But yeah, when you get just east of the front range of the Rockies, that's where the wind flow patterns really make for some really gnarly turbulence. Hey, Al, how about yourself? Have you ever encountered some pretty strong turbulence?
Yeah, there's a few areas in my sort of flying world that we get it. There's quite often a band of turbulence about 30 or 40 minutes to the north of Dubai that just seems to live there pretty much all year round. And the one that we get most turbulence off, generally speaking, in Europe is crossing over the Alps between France, Italy, Germany, Switzerland, and Austria. By sort of worldwide terms, they aren't especially high mountains, but I've had both mountain wave off the Alps, and also last year. Now we're quite lucky in that part of the world; we have very good air traffic control, and we were advised about 20 minutes before reaching an area of severe turbulence, and we. Elected. I was coming back from Sharm el Sheikh to Manchester, which is around about a 6 hour, 20 minute flight. So we elected to drop down to flight level 300, if I remember rightly, just to give ourselves a bit more margin between where we get a bit twitchy because the speed's gone a bit low to where we get a bit twitchy where the speed's gone a bit high. Generally speaking, on large transport aircraft, the higher you go, the more the less of a margin that you have between slow speed and high speed issues or handling issues. So we descended to give ourselves a bit more margin, And we had a pretty rough ride down there for about 20 minutes. And I was talking on the emergency frequency, the guard frequency, 1 to 1.5, to captain of another UK airline, probably one of our competitors. And he was getting an awfully rough ride above us. And we had a little conversation along the lines of, well, why don't you come down here? Because you're going to give yourself a bit more margin. The ride might not be better, but you're going to feel a bit more comfortable about it. And he said, well, I don't have, you know, the fuel to come down. We won't make our destination. And I said, well, you might not make your destination if you stay up there for too much longer anyway. So come down here and then reevaluate later on. And a few minutes later, they ended up doing an emergency descent out of the turbulence. And, you know, that was possibly a lesson learned for that crew without trying to be particularly clever, smart or anything. It's just born out of experience, really.
Lately, it's been like that in the southeastern United States. You hear that kind of conversation going on. You hear the guys that are on, you know, one of those longer segment flights, and they say, we really can't go lower because of fuel consumption. But on the other hand, as you just mentioned, you know, sometimes it's just better to bite the bullet, go down, and then, you know, stop short and get some more fuel if you can. Otherwise, you're going to be in a situation where you're going to have to fill out a lot of paperwork.
Absolutely. And the other thing is that I think some guys lose grasp of the fact that at some point on a long flight, you're going to climb back up. So you're not going to remain at that low level for the entire remainder of the flight. So your FMS might be predicting less than desirable arrival fuel if you say that you're going to drop down to flight level 300. But you also need to tell it that you're going to go back up to 37, 38, 39 or whatever in an hour or so to give yourself, the best information. It's garbage in, garbage out. Yeah, you're far better off arriving at an airport 100 miles short of your destination in one piece than not making it in any pieces.
That's right. Or many pieces.
Yes.
So that happened to me last week. We were flying from LaGuardia down to Miami, and we got to a certain section in southern Georgia, northern panhandle of Florida area, where the rides were just horrible, and you had to go all the way down. We were at 34,000 feet, and to get a reasonably good ride, not smooth, but much better, you had to go down 10,000 feet to 24,000 or flight level 240. And I said, you know, it's we have to do this. You know, we just have to burn the extra fuel to do this. And so we were down there for maybe 10 or 15 minutes. And then we started hearing reports of people up back at those higher altitudes saying the ride was pretty good. And so we said, well, let's go back up again. And so we watched our fuel consumption estimation of fuel remaining at our arrival drop about 1,000 pounds when we descended to the lower altitude. But then when we popped back up again, guess what? Most of that fuel came back as far as the estimate for our arrival fuel and required reserves and alternate fuel and everything else. So interesting discussion. So thank you. Is there anything else that Brett had asked that we should address before we move on?
I think that was it.
Okay.
We can't help you with your inappropriate laughter, though.
This is something that you'll have to go to a psychiatrist for, I think.
Yes.
Right, and it may actually be part of the APG syndrome. And again, we can't help you there. Sorry.
I'm compiling a list of symptoms. We'll publish the definitive paper on it.
Yes. Just quickly, Big Data Ken sent a picture, and this is sent to me back on the 5th of April. He wished all of us a blessed and happy Easter to the APG crew from the Big Data Boys. And he snapped a selfie from his iPhone inside his airplane, general aviation airplane. I'm not sure what that is. Can you tell?
Looks like a Cessna of some sort.
Yeah.
I'm going to guess.
It's got Cessna air vents, hasn't it? I'm looking at the air vents, and it's got a touch of Cessna about it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's a great photo. Guess. I'll put this photo,
it's a fantastic photo
in the show notes so you can all look at it as well. So thanks for sending that. It's just good. You know, again, how many times have we said it's the APG community that makes the show? It's not the show that makes the community. And
he's got the next generation right there.
Yes.
With the kids.
Exactly. And
starting them young.
It's great. It's great. Love it. So thank you. Thank you, Ken, for sending that in. That just made me smile. It still does. Let's see. Matt said, cue the drone music. So he says, oh, Captain, my Captain, I thought this may be newsworthy. Seems there are drone pilots who are responsible and care about the safety of others. This man wants to make a transponder for UAVs with collision avoidance technology. It's a bit of a lengthy read, and he includes a link at the bottom of his email, but worth it. And so this is from Matt, the former freight dog. And this is regarding a, I think it was a Kickstarter or a Indiegogo or one of those crowdsourcing mm-hmm. funding things, where he has a non-functioning prototype. And I'm not sure how far he's gotten so far, but where it's a device that is relatively inexpensive, I'm guessing, that can be attached to a drone and work at as a transponder device that will help deconflict drones or UAVs or UASs or whatever you want to call them with other aerospace vehicles. And I thought that that was worth mentioning, and so did Matt. And if you want to check it out, we'll put a link to this in the show notes. And I think he did the funding initially, the initial funding request back in, what, early last year?
I know I clicked on the Kickstarter link, but I don't remember the details. And I'm not sure how far he's gotten with funding for it.
I think his problem, he said the five backers pledged $85 to help bring this project to life. I think
it's not much.
That he should have asked for a heck of a lot more. And perhaps things would have gotten going a little bit faster with this. But I don't know. I haven't checked recently to see how everything is going for this. But it's really interesting. And so there are people out there, as Matt says, that are responsible, and they understand that it is a risk to airplanes, you know, flying these devices around. And let's put our heads together and come up with a way to make it safe. So that's cool, I think.
If the FAA are going to ask the airlines for $80 million to improve simulators, are the FAA going to go to the drone manufacturers and say, I think you're going to have to fund this project?
I think they should. You're absolutely right. The gentleman that came up with this idea is Patrick Coleman. I think in one of the blog posts that he made, he was presenting something at some conference, the IEEE, some kind of a conference, and people were trying to buy the device from him, like, you know, right there. And these were like just prototypes. And he said, I can't.
He's like, I haven't actually made it yet. I need you to fund my Kickstarter so I can actually, you know, the way Kickstarter works, you have this idea, you have the plans for it. But if you've ever funded something on Kickstarter, you know, it takes a lot of time because there's actually a lot of research and development that goes into these projects after they're funded, because they need the capital to be able to do those things before it's all set up. So
it's very interesting. So if you want to check it out, we'll put that link in the show notes. You can check out his blog and the Kickstarter site and see how things are progressing with that. This is from Soren in Denmark. He says, hi, Jeff and company. I'm new to this podcast. I really don't want to listen to all the past podcasts.
That's just
this is anti-APV syndrome, apparently, with Soren. That being said, I've missed some basic personal information about you guys. But hopefully you can answer a few of my questions. And so he has a whole list of questions. I'm thinking, what a lazy son of a gun, this guy. And I looked at, oh, wait a minute. His last name is Nielsen.
He's kin.
Yeah, I think
he's actually related to you.
I understand now that he's a little bit lazy. He wants things to come to him.
It's hereditary. It's a genetic trait.
I think it is.
Of the Nielsen.
So it turns out that Nielsen's kind of a common name in Denmark, apparently. But hey, maybe we're related, Soren.
To a penny.
Anyway, so, okay. Well, I'll tell you what. Let's make a deal, Soren. We'll answer a couple of these, okay? Favorite aircraft. And now you don't have the whole crew here either, but I can tell you my favorite aircraft. Carlos knows my favorite aircraft is the L-1011, the Lockheed L-1011, and the Boeing 727. Those are my two favorite air transport category airplanes. What is your favorite aircraft, Al?
That would be the A330. I know the old curmudgeon whinges and moans about flying the little Airbus, but for me, it was always the big Airbus. And yeah, I mean, you can have too many engines, can't you?
I suppose not.